Hello. I have with me two eminent persons who've been working in the area of labor law and particularly the teaching of labor law. I have to my left Professor Kamala Shankar, who has taught at Delhi University and is presently the Vice Chancellor of the Tamil Nadu National Law School. And I have with me Saurabh Bhattacharya, who is an assistant professor at the NUJS Law School. I will be talking to both of them, asking them about their experiences in teaching labor law over a period of time, and how they think the field has evolved, and what are the ways in which this conference on socioeconomic rights has given them new thoughts on how they would like to teach labor law. I will start with Professor Kamala Shankaran and ask her to tell us her experiences in the Delhi University over a period of time. Has she seen an evolution, and how her background in constitutional law has also impacted on the way in which she understands labor law and the teaching of it?
Thank you. Thank you. I must say that it's some years since I taught labor law. I started teaching labor law, but since I've moved to teaching constitutional law and jurisprudence. But labor law is something that I've worked on and I research on, and I've had close interaction with and taught it and lectured on this area for a great period of time. One of the things that has always struck me is the law and the way it is taught is sometimes not in sync with the changes that are taking place in the world of work. So if we were to look at India, for example, there is an overwhelming emphasis on laws pertaining to the organized sector and those dealing with those who work in factories, establishments, other organizations that are covered under the IDA Act, Industrial Standards Act, etc. There is invisibility of the informal sector, invisibility of the unorganized worker. That is a problem that is there. And many of us have been writing about this, and I am extremely glad that this conference on socioeconomic rights that ANSAR has organized has served to flag it and bring it onto the agenda as a agenda for curricular reform. And I do hope that there will be a takeaway on this point. Secondly, there is a need, as we were discussing in the morning in the conference itself, there is a need to bring the changes that are happening in the world of work into the classroom. And this would necessarily mean that experiences that workers, those in employment relationships, those who are self-employed, how those stories get reflected in the class, the use of not necessarily legal material, but using other kinds of material to enrich the classroom discussion. And to understand that the boundaries of labor law are not just confined to those who work in factories. You know, that's an older imagination. Today, people are scattered all over. They're employed, they're working, they may be self-employed, and labor law needs to capture all of that.
Thank you so much. Yeah, Saurabh,
would you
like to share your views on this?
I'd like to second Professor Shankaran's view that we need to go beyond legal materials to really introduce students to the realities of the world of work. And I think to that extent, perhaps this conference would allow us to reflect much more strongly and in a concerted manner at what kind of changes can be brought about. But I'd also like to have your views on this challenge of covering as much as we can in this hugely voluminous material of labor regimes. And it's a challenge that as a young teacher of labor law, I face that every time I try to move away from statutes and case laws, there would be a question that are we being unfair to students, because they would be expected to deal with some of the statutes in their work. And as much as we would say that these statutes reflect only at best 10% of our workforce, and to that extent we do have a strong obligation to go beyond them, but there is also an institutional response that we need to focus on the relevant statutory regimes that are there. So how exactly do we negotiate this tension?
If I can phrase that question differently, I also face the same problem when I'm teaching labor law, and usually in our curriculum meetings we always have this question, okay, how much time I'm going to spend on statute, how much time I'm going to spend on case law. I wanted to look at this, tell both of us this, that when labor is a field that is like cross-cutting many other areas. So you do have a whole range of history in economics, and in fact, perhaps the most exciting work is happening in economics and not in law. As lawyers, should we really necessarily enter into those areas, which are not really our areas? They are areas for political scientists. They are areas for history or economists. As lawyers, do we find ourselves equipped to enter those areas? And are we somewhere blurring the boundaries when we move into those areas? That's how I would like to rephrase the question. Are we moving beyond our expertise? Because our expertise is statute and case law, and that's essentially what we're doing. Would that be right?
Let me put it this way. For example, even when we are dealing with statutes, I think there's a considerable leeway that we can do to bring material outside the statute in. For example, take the Trade Unions Act. We know that it uses the word employed and engaged in section 6E. And we bring into the classroom the fact that SEWA, a self-employed trade union, can also be there. So you could have a trade union which doesn't necessarily have an employer with whom they are engaged in collective bargaining. So there are those spaces where we can bring the changes that are happening. A large number of the agricultural workers' unions are recognized and are registered under the Trade Unions Act, and they don't necessarily have an employer-employee relationship. So I think it's also a myth to say that the law is already stuck in a particular place. It has considerable what your project calls indeterminacy, which one can highlight. Number two, on your other point that you raised about what is our domain of expertise, I think somebody who does labor law, like somebody who teaches, well, off the top of my head, constitutional law, necessarily needs to engage in politics, political theory, because that so much resonates with what we teach as lawyers, and we do require to know some things about developments that are going on in other areas. And I think in the case of labor law, the synergy between economics, sociology is so deep. How could we understand the changes in the world of work if we didn't know whether unionization rates were going up or down? If we didn't know that there was a drop in the female work participation rates, what would we do in things like that? So even in terms of the Industrial Disputes Act, we need to look at data to know how many disputes are there, how many workers are under contract, if we're teaching contract labor. And I think over a period of time, consciously, we do build our expertise in those other areas, but I agree with you. We go there, but we go also, we're more comfortable in our original domain. But I think there are these spaces that we have to explore, and we shouldn't hold ourselves back.
So one is about the use of materials, using materials to demonstrate your own discipline. And I think that's what you're saying, that you use materials from other disciplines, but it's necessarily, the project is a legal project, it continues to be a law project. Because sometimes when we enter into the other disciplines, and I'm talking from student feedback where they say that, okay, this has become sociology 3 or this has become political science, so it seems to be an entirely different area. It doesn't seem like law. So that is a challenge. I don't know if you face the same challenge of, you know, when you sometimes in unorganized labor, for example, there's literally nothing to teach. If you have to teach, you inevitably end up teaching other kinds of materials which are not.
Yeah, it's a difficult balance, and we know that there is a student comfort level in teaching black letter law, which we have to teach.
We have to teach doctrine.
We can't run away with that. So I think to the extent possible, but I think when we as teachers read more, we can bring it in a condensed, very quick form into the classroom.
That's right.
And I think we also need to challenge the students. Because yes, there is a certain degree of comfort with the traditional black letter method, but any reading of law which is solely black letter would be myopic in many ways. So as much as students may be more comfortable, our role is not to only move in the terrain that they are comfortable with, but rather push them up beyond their comfort zone. So to that extent, and I think it's very important, as Dr. Shankaran said, that we need to read law more, and our understanding perhaps can then distill those insights from sociological and economic literature. And after first couple of years of teaching labor and industrial law, I actually, for minimum wages, went fairly deeply into the literature on minimum wages, and I found that the discussion on minimum wages became a lot more livelier as opposed to simply looking at the statute. But of course, there is also another tension that I found, that a lot of the literature also reflects a specific economic worldview.
That's where,
as a lawyer, for us to make a call between what kind of neoclassical literature is really well argued and how reasoned and substantive the criticisms are, becomes a little difficult to navigate.
And if you want to do what is called a balanced approach, then you'll have to actually give the different opinions and the different spaces from which that material is coming from for students to have a picture. Whereas in law, you can actually stick to just the black letter law, you can stick to statute and interpretation, at the most theory, and then kind of close it rather than.
But I think the conference has opened up a lot of spaces and a lot of questions. And so since it's being anchored at NISA, and one of its byproducts is to be curricular reform, and I think that there's a lot of rich insights that we can have, and one can take away from that and see how do we balance it. After all, a semester is a lot of time. And the students' projects would be the space where they can explore those on their own. This may not necessarily be part of the classroom discussion. It can be, but doesn't need to spend much time.
So in terms of materials, last comments, in terms of specific materials that you would want to use to teach labor law, what is it that you think an ideal curriculum would be?
It's very difficult to give this quick answer like this. But you know, things like the reports of the National Commission, which are rich in materials, reports of conditions of work of different groups of people, some element of labor history, because the historical approach always situates the student in a good place. He's able to understand. So I think your project
is
going to develop. So we are all of us looking keenly to see what will be produced. And you know, I think it's a wonderful step that has taken place in the legal curriculum. We're very happy. So we're looking forward for us to show us what the
any ideas, what is it that curriculum?
We have tried to look at, as Ma'am said, labor history, quite a bit of material on industrial sociology is another that we have tried to look at. But the other part that we have tried quite emphatically to do is to look at case studies and also interview a lot of the activists from various unions to get direct perspective on operation of law. And even some of the interviews that we are doing here as part of this seminar, we hope to use some of them as part of the resource material, because that gives us a much more live perspective from actors involved. Other thing that I have tried using in my labor law course material and also in the law impoverishment course that I teach is to use a lot of newspaper material. And especially while the mainstream media has pretty much ignored labor as such, but persons like Neha Dixit and others in the alternate media have done a lot of contemporary work, and I think that becomes a very useful way to clarify some of the points to students, and often they relate much more to those reportages than academic literature, if I may say so. So these are some of the materials we are going to try and experiment with. In fact, we'll be looking towards feedback from various teachers as to how useful some of these can be. And we really look forward to receiving inputs on how to refine it, and perhaps also look towards a long-term cases and materials or a resource book been published as a kind of all
I think the best part of the conference was the bringing together of people from such different backgrounds, and the panel that we had in the morning had people from the journalist field, people from academics, people from people as working as lawyers and as activists, and to try and include all of those perspectives into labor law would certainly make it a very exciting project to be involved in.